Good morning, and welcome to Belonging Fellowship. I'm Pastor Tanya, and we are excited to have you here on this Sunday morning. Let's start service with prayer and welcoming in the Holy Spirit to lead us and to guide us. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this day and this opportunity to come together. We thank you for the ability to connect virtually from home to home, from city to city and state to state. We thank you for our belongers all across the country that are connecting with us, some on YouTube, some on Facebook, some through our app. However they are connecting, we give you glory, God, for allowing us to make that connection. Now, God, we welcome your Holy Spirit with us, who dwells with us, but we pray right now that you stir your Holy Spirit up inside of us so that we are ready to receive a word from you. Have thine own way in this space. Have thine own way in this place. Have thine own way in each and every one of us, and we'll be ever so careful to give your name the honor, the glory, and the praise. It is in Jesus the Christ's name that we all say, amen.
God bless you. God bless you. We'd like to just say thank you, God, for allowing us to be here and worship with you on today. We ask that you just get up out of your seats wherever you are. If you have headphones in your ears, we want you to just listen and worship with us. Hallelujah. Whoa. So good to be in the house of the Lord today. We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging seas. Our God holds every victory. You know why, God? There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house. And we won't be. We shout out your praise. There's joy. Oh, our God is surely in this place. Yes, we shout out your praise. We just call on the name of Jesus. We're so delighted to be in the house of the Lord. Yes, we do. We sing to a God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always gives away. Cause upon the cross you shed your blood. Then you rose up on the grave. My God still rolled the stones away. There is joy. Yes, it is. Of the Lord today, we walk in, we shout out your praise. There's joy. Yes, our God is surely in this place. Wherever we are, we shout out your praise. Yes, we do. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by your grace. That the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running.
Sure. Holy One. You are the Holy One. Yes, you are. You are so holy. Yes, you are, God. Next song says this: holy, holy, holy.
Holy, holy, holy. Holy.
Exalt his name as we continue to worship the Lord.
It's giving time. Here at Belonging Fellowship, there's many ways that you can give. The first way is if you choose to mail a donation. You can see the address in the description for whatever platform that you're watching us on. The second way to give is through Tithely. We have Givelify, and we also have Venmo. Or if you're watching us on your computer and connecting through your computer or your iPad, you can pick up your telephone and text to give. And that number is 844-976-4293. However you choose to give, now it's giving time. And for this month, we're preparing for November. I know this is our Breast Cancer Awareness Month, but we were preparing in this month to be able to do some major work with breast cancer awareness. So as you are giving during the month of October, you're helping us to prepare for our free mammograms in November. Women in the U.S. have a 1 in 8 chance of getting breast cancer during their lifetime. So regular screening is so important. And today there are more than 4 million breast cancer survivors in the U.S. That is more than any other group of cancer survivors. And anyone who has been diagnosed with breast cancer is considered a survivor from the time of diagnosis through the end of their life. Y'all, breast cancer can be detected through early detection, and that plays an important role in your health. I had my mammogram last week because I have insurance and could have it done without needing someone else's assistance. I want us to partner together so that we're able to give as many free mammograms as possible and free screenings as possible in November. We are going to be reminding you all month of October that this is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And we want to remind you that what you are giving during this giving moment is going to be used to help us prepare for our mammogram bus, which is scheduled for November the 19th from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. at South Elementary School. That's 1333 Hurdle Mills Road in Roxburgh, North Carolina. We'll be giving away free mammograms. And if you're able to help us and contribute enough for us to do a more than once visit, we'll be able to do another city. Our first scheduled city is November the 19th in Roxborough at South Elementary. And you'll be able to sign up and get an appointment in the next couple of days. But that's why I'm telling you now, because it's giving time. And we need your help so that we can give away as many free mammograms, as many opportunities for screening as we possibly can. So maybe you're watching from another ministry. Your church can donate and help us give away free mammograms. It's giving time. Won't you search your heart and give so that we can give the gift of health screenings? Let's pray. God, we thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for this moment of giving. Now, God, we pray that you lead us and guide us so that we give a portion of what you have already given unto us. And in that portion that we give to Belonging Fellowship, we pray that we're able to help so many people get screenings, not only with breast cancer, but in other screenings and health screenings that we can possibly bring together on that day. Have that away in this giving moment. And let us be careful to use the gifts that are given to do the work for your people. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Y'all, it's giving time. Join me in the book of John, chapter 10. As we are continuing our series, Rediscovering the Great I Am. John chapter 10, beginning at verse number 7, and it reads, "So Jesus again said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I came that they may have a life and have it abundantly." Y'all, this is the word of the Lord for the people. Thanks be unto God. For this Sunday, I'd simply like to name this one, the right door. The right door. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this preaching moment. And I pray now that you shallow me, O Lord, shallow me, until there's more of thee and less of me. Shallow me, O Lord, shallow me, until there's more of thee and less of me. Shallow me, O Lord, shallow me, until there's all of thee and none of me. I'll give your name the honor, the glory, and the praise. It is in Jesus the Christ's name. We all say, amen. Amen. Have you ever been in a room full of people, people that you may know and some you may not know. They may even look like you, or maybe they don't look like you, but you are in the room with them and you realize you might be in the same space with them, but you really don't fit in. Or have you ever wanted to be a part of an organization or a group and look forward to the day of being included, but when your turn came, they didn't accept you and you were met with rejection? Have you ever gone to a place or a club, we ain't been saved always, and the bouncer at the door bypassed you and let others behind you in while you stood waiting patiently to get in? Have you ever wanted to be picked for a team or assignment and everyone was picked except you? Some form of rejection has happened to all of us. At some point in our lives, we have been overlooked, disqualified, passed by, or passed over. At some point, we have experienced someone else telling us if we are good enough, smart enough, talented enough, tall enough, small enough, or quiet enough. All throughout our lives, we have been held up to the measuring stick that someone else created, waiting for them to tell us if we fit in, can get in, or be in. Yet, they did not create us. So why do we allow others to tell us if we are accepted? Why do we allow others to determine our value or if we are welcome at their raggedy tables? Why do we allow the opinion of others to determine who we are? Well, now we know why. We know why, because we all want and desire to be a part of the group. We want to be in the in crowd. We want to be the who's who. We want folk to know our names. We want to be VIP with VIP treatment. We want to be popular and successful. We want to be at the big kids' table. We just want to be in. We want in whatever the happening thing is, so we feel like we are enough and that we measure up to that made-up measuring stick. The problem is they keep changing the measurements on us. It is an ever-evolving measurement that determines if they will accept us. Yet so many of us keep chasing it. We keep trying to get in and be in, yet we don't realize the cost of fitting in and getting in. But to be honest, many of us don't care as long as we are in. Because if we are in, we are not on the outside looking in. But the problem is, there's a problem with the whole thing. The problem with this whole rat race to get in is that in order for folk to be in the in crowd, someone has to be on the outside. There must be a separation of those who are in and those who are out. And if there is a separation of those who are in and those who are out, the real question then becomes, who is the gatekeeper? Who is holding the measuring stick for us to measure up to? That's what we see in this passage for today. A man who was born with no physical sight, who had to encounter a situation and some situations thereafter. This man had an encounter with Jesus, and Jesus gave him the ability to use his physical eyes. And the people who saw this man previously with no sight couldn't believe what they had witnessed. And some began to question what happened, who healed him, and was it really real? They take him to the Pharisees, and they even ask him who had opened his eyes. They ask this man to give the account of what happened, and he does. He tells them quite simply, there was a man who put some mud on my eyes and he told me to go wash, and I washed and now I see. But the Pharisees are upset. This in crowd is upset. They're upset because this was done on the Sabbath and they don't really know much about this person because this person is not in the in crowd. So they ask the man again, what do you say about this man who did this to you? And the man who had the experience said, well, I guess he's a prophet. Others, they did not believe that the man received a sight, so they kept on asking questions. They even asked his parents to tell them what happened. And the parents were like, look, he is grown. If you have questions, you need to ask him. So the people began to ask him questions again. And all the man said was, whether he is a sinner or not, I do not know. One thing I do know is that though I was blind, now I see. And they said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? And the same man, he answered them, I have already told you. I've told you over and over, and you do not want to listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to be a disciple? This group, these Pharisees, this in crowd got upset with this man, and they cast him out. But the thing is, he was never really in. Yet they cast him out. Jesus hears about them casting him out and putting him out of their in crowd, and Jesus goes to look for him. Jesus finds him and has a conversion conversation with him, and the man, the unnamed man, begins to believe in Jesus. Then Jesus has a conversation with the Pharisees who are watching, the Pharisees who kicked the man out, and they said to this man that he did not belong. Jesus turns to them and has another conversation, and then begins to say, truly, truly, I tell you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters the door, by the door, is the shepherd of the sheep. To him, the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he was brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of the strangers. And Jesus does this whole sheep analogy and shepherd analogy, this figure of speech, Jesus used this to help them. But y'all, they still didn't understand, because remember, they're in the in crowd, and Jesus doesn't speak quite the same language as the in crowd, because Jesus ain't in. So Jesus says yet again to them, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to kill and steal and destroy. I came that they may have a life and have it abundantly. Jesus looked at the Pharisees and informs them, you know, the in crowd, that he is the door or gate, and that he decides who enters, and when they enter, they can belong there and be taken care of. They don't have to worry about anyone kicking them out. They don't have to worry about being cast out. They don't have to worry about anyone questioning them or their abilities. But when they enter through him, they will be saved. They can have freedom and security because he did not come to destroy them or kick them out, but he came so that they would have an abundant life. It's got me thinking, for too long, We have allowed others to be the gatekeepers and determine if we get in, if we fit in, if we can participate, if we are good enough, if we are welcome, when the only gatekeeper we really need to meet is the one that said, I have come that you may have a life and have it more abundantly. And when you get into this gate, you don't have to worry about rejection because he will never reject you. You don't have to worry about being passed over because he will always see you. You don't have to worry about being enough because he said you are already enough. You don't have to worry about fitting in because he designed you to be the light that shines bright and not hidden. You don't have to worry about having enough because he will provide everything that you need. You don't have to worry about being in the right crowd because he is always right, even when the crowd is wrong. You don't have to worry about having a seat at the table because he invites you to dine at his table. You don't have to worry about being put out because he said you can go out and go in and still find pasture. You don't have to worry about getting in because he is the door, and that will always be the door that will let you in. All you have to do is be like the man who was put out by one group but loved and received by the gatekeeper. All you have to do is say, Lord, I believe, and worship him. So what they may have put you out, all you need to say is, Lord, I believe and I will worship you. So what they did invite you, Lord, I believe and I will worship you. So what you are not in the in crowd, Lord, I believe and I will worship you. So what they overlooked you, Lord, I believe and I will worship you. So what they counted you out, Lord, I believe and I will worship you. So what they didn't invite you to their little raggedy table, Lord, I believe and I will worship you. And because I believe, I will worship you. And Lord, I already know that you have a table prepared for me. I know you will provide for me. I know you will protect me. I know you will watch over me when I am coming in and when I am going out. I know you will love me just as I am. I know I look good enough because you made me. I know I am in the right place because I made it through the right door. See, through this door, I have everything I need. Through this door, I have found real love. Through this door, I have found real protection. Through this door, I have found real security. Through this door, I have found a life more abundantly. So it is okay when they reject you. It is okay when you don't fit in. It is okay when they overlook you. Because the doorman named Jesus is ready to open the door to the life that you have been wanting and waiting for. And all you have to do is walk through the right door, believe, and worship him. You don't need the approval of anyone but him. You don't have to fit in to any crowd. Just be a part of the crowd with Jesus. Just be a part of the sheep that walk through the gate. And when you walk in, Jesus promises that you can go in and out and find pasture and safety. So often that is what we are looking for. We're looking for a place not only to belong, but to feel safe, to feel seen, to feel like somebody. And I want you to know all the places that you have been searching, they're the wrong place. All you need to do is be at the right door. The door that says, I came that you have, may have life and have it more abundantly. Walk through that door, receive that door, and your life will begin to change. No, it may not be magic and all of a sudden tomorrow it's a brand new day with all the things you've ever dreamed of, but you will have more peace. You will have more love. And you'll be able to see the shift that God makes in your life. So stop trying to get into doors of false and fake gatekeepers or bouncers who determine your worth and your value. Instead, go to the door. Go to the gate that will let you in and take care of you. And that door's name is Jesus. And all you have to do is just like the man did in chapter 9 and say, I believe. I believe. All you have to do is say, I believe, and worship him. Not people, things, and stuff, but worship him. My prayer for you this week is that you stop chasing and knocking at the wrong doors and the wrong crowds. And instead, believe in the real door, in the one that once you walk through that door, your life will be changed for the better. God, we thank you today. We thank you for the right door. We thank you that your son says that he came so that we have life more abundantly. And that in these moments of rediscovering the great I am, God, we rediscover you and we rediscover Jesus. And in this moment, Jesus says, I am the door, I am the gate, I am the access point to an abundant life. Let us receive that access point so that we can walk in the life that we've dreamed of, a life with more love and more joy and more peace, a life that is centered around you, a life that gives us what we need. So as we walk away from the in crowds, let us seek after Jesus, where we will be safe and secure. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're looking for a place to belong, Belonging Fellowship is that place. Call us today. Send us a message. We'll pray with you. Download the app so that you can stay connected to us, so we can continue to work together to help one another and to help this world. I believe that there's a shift taking place, and there's so many people looking for that right door, a door that will receive them for who they are. Belonging Fellowship is saying, come with us. We'll love you just as you are. And we'll make sure that we are all journeying together through the right door, on the right path, following the great I am. And if no one has told you today, let me be the first to say, I love you, and so does the Lord. God bless you. We'll see you Wednesday night for Bible study.